But I mean, I heard a lot four totally fascinating cases. There's issues around asymmetry of information, short versus long routes to accountability, citizens as the recipients of information, but also as generating information, the impacts of whether they're vested directly in the implications of that information being used, or if they're further removed, does that affect their engagement and levels of participation? And also, I think Molly's piece at the end there, this whole point around transparency might be something that groups are quite comfortable with, but it becomes much more either an asset and a point for agency when it connects to participation, or a risk when it connects to participation. And that's the real piece where we get social change. So how do we better enable that? So lots of food for thought. I'm just going to open it up. Can I ask, hopefully I have someone with a roving mic, and why don't we take two or three questions right now and just sort of say your name and organization and try and keep your questions brief, and that would be great. So who has I can see one lady already with her hand up over there. Do we have a microphone? Ah, it's up here.
Hello, I'm Radhika Shah. I'm a co-president of a Stanford Tech Innovation Club, Stanford Angels and Entrepreneurs, and an advisor to their Sustainable Development Goals Philanthropy platform. My question is for all the panelists or any of you, how important is the role of having very different type of standards and policy for infotech to play a key role in civic society, getting information, participating? How much is it technology versus needing a significant shift in policy? And for example, with the UN Sustainable, with the new Secretary General, there were questions civic society could ask, and it was a process change even more than technology, that those questions were part of the selection process. How much is that of a factor? And if so, can organizations like the ITU play a role, or would it be national level, or could the UN play a role?
Great. Let's take a couple more if people... Right. Who else has I think there's one gentleman here. Yep.
Thanks. Doug Wyatt with the Human Rights Law Network in New Delhi. Some of the presentations talked about some of the different technological platforms you're dealing with, smartphones versus dumb phones, and kind of how that impacts the kind of questions you can ask and the kind of people that you're getting in your data set. Have you thought much about the trends that you're seeing in these places and how technology is shifting, both on the handsets and what kind of social media penetration is going on, and how that might change the kind of experiments you would run in the next 5 years, or what kind of programs that you could run based on not necessarily today's technology, but what we're going to be seeing soon?
Great. And do we have one more? Yes, we have.
I want to ask Molly if she's still allowed to go to China.
Oh, that's a very practical question. I like that. And so we have this one around the importance of the role of the tech versus policy changes, this piece around the trends you're seeing in terms of the use of the technology. I'm intrigued on how much you think that a lot of you talk to credibility of the information. I'm also intrigued about how much the source of the information matters. I saw a study recently about citizens more intrinsically trust satellite data more than they do other, like, because it's seen as direct from technology and impartial in ways that, you know, other data sources. So, and particularly with the whole debates we see now over fake news and credibility of facts, and like how much that came into your thinking. And why don't we try and, I don't expect you to try and answer all of them, so maybe we'll just go down the line and pick up on the question that you're most interested in and sort of do 1 minute each, and then I'm going to come back to you just to end, like, what's the one thing with your magic wand you'd want to do that would strengthen this bottom-up accountability? So I don't know who cares to go first. Come on.
So I've got the mic, so I'll go first. So I guess I'll answer the question about whether this should be more from the policy side or more from the sort of technology side, since I did a crowdsource type innovation. I should say, and I didn't really talk about this, that our partner in this was the government. Right. So they were helping set this up and make sure government vets were engaged in this. So there was a component, even to build a crowdsource platform, that we first had to have the government on board. And I think that's going to be common in a lot of these settings. So I think these things are complementary. I think, you know, the fact that Umar is sitting right here is a good example of that as well. So someone who's a policymaker and driving the technology side. So I actually think that's more of a strength of the type of people working in the space right now and a lot of opportunities there.
I'll address the question about technology platforms. We've done a lot of work looking at, you know, how response rates differ and how people take in information differently. So, for example, we found that you have an enormous differential response rate. If you push questions out to people via SMS, they will answer them on a dumb phone. If you ask people to navigate through a menu on a dumb phone, they will not do it, and they will only do that on a smartphone. So even though there appear to be very analogous ways of using USSD that look to be organized like a website, they don't get used that way. And it ends up meaning that the architecture that you have to engineer to get effective participation with dumb phones is very different. In terms of where things are going, I guess I have a two-part answer. So one is SMS is so cheap. And even if smartphones as hardware start to disseminate more broadly, let's say in sub-Saharan Africa, the data charges on the margin are so high in that environment that I think many people are still going to be tempted to be using the smartphone to interact via SMS rather than going on and trying to open up a web platform with a smartphone. The second part is that, you know, Silicon Valley is spending billions every minute on innovation on smartphones. And I think that in a way, the innovation that we need to be pushing, because it isn't what is happening from the private sector, is the innovation that is working over legacy channels, because that is really the thing that is going to be pushing ICT interventions out to the very poor and very isolated parts of the developing world over the course of the next few years. So I want to put a pitch that, you know, this audience that is kind of blending private technology with public funding, that's a very appropriate thing for us to be trying to do.
Just to speak to your question about the source of information and legitimacy, I think this was really important with the debates project. There's a bunch of studies that are more of a scorecard style approach. So they take, you know, members of parliament and they compile information and then they disseminate that. Some of those work and some of those don't. And one of the things, anecdotally, there was a study that McCartan Humphreys and Jeremy Weinstein did in Uganda that didn't work. And one of the things that they said was that the politicians went around and discredited the scorecard. It's like, who put this together? This, I'm way better than this. Like, my attendance is twice this rate. And I think the nice thing about debates is that you can't argue with a video of your own face making promises. And so it creates this public and enduring archive, at least that, you know, you're on record saying something, and maybe you can say you changed your mind. But, you know, it's harder than just saying this is not a legitimate source of information.
Yeah, so, okay, is this on? Yep. So I can go to China. I'm going next week, so, yeah. I'm interested in just studying censorship and propaganda. I don't have a policy agenda necessarily. It is a really good question, and especially how research interfaces with governance, I think, is something that's a broader theme of the panel. And I think that there are questions obviously about that. So a few things on credibility. So I think that the Chinese government says that its censorship program is there to prevent rumors and misinformation, which is really interesting given our current experience here. Interestingly, because when people are aware of censorship, I do think that they believe more in misinformation and rumors. Because if you think that the information environment is being manipulated, then it, in some sense, it backfires, and you think, well, maybe that's true then, even if I don't see it a lot. So there's this interesting justification for censorship and propaganda as spreading truth, right? Political justification. But then sometimes that can create an environment where there's competitive spreading of truth and then that undermines the credibility of the entire information environment. So I think that's something I'm trying to study a lot right now, is sort of paying people to get the right answer to questions and seeing how much they learn from different types of information sources and also how much they're aware of censorship. Yeah.
So Molly, what's the one thing you'd love to see funded, or the opportunity you see out there that no one's looking at around getting to accountability or around the issues that you'd like to follow up on? Is there one thing?
So I think that there's a lot of really interesting questions. So a lot of censorship in China is about taxing information, so making information more difficult to access, but not necessarily prohibiting its access. So like the Great Firewall makes it more difficult to access websites from the US, but you can download a VPN and you can get there. It just takes you a little more time and money. And data availability is actually very similar. So governments can sometimes make data very easy to access where there's no barriers to access, right? Or they can make it, you know, you have to like jump through a lot of hoops in order to get this type of information. So I think that thinking about censorship more broadly and also thinking about the actual incentives, the governance incentives for providing data and what those incentives might be, and trying to understand how data transparency varies by locality based on those incentives. I think that's something that I'm really interested in looking at in the future, and I think that's general to a lot of the different questions that are being asked here.
So I think when you look at, for me, when you look at the general election in places in U.S. as well, where there's, you know, really deep party strongholds, I'm looking at how can you get voters participating in the within-party candidate selection process? Because if whoever the party puts forward wins, then the general election is a little bit irrelevant. And so you can be like beautifully enfranchised on paper, but de facto irrelevant. So I'm trying to see, can we push more just rank-and-file party members or ordinary voters into the primary process?
You know, when we do academic studies, we have to get informed consent from our subjects. We have to tell them who we are, where is the information coming from, and in the kind of project like we ran, that creates just a very strange informational environment for people that they're getting messages from the University of California about. So basically, the electoral commissions in developing countries are the proper parties to be trying to kind of create this direct linkage all the way to the ground and all the way to the citizens. Mike has some really interesting work on kind of the industrial organizations of corruption and where does that happen in the electoral process. So I'd really like to see the electoral commissions get involved in taking, you know, ground truth, crowdsourced data seriously as a way of trying to understand what's going on and building a deeper link with the citizenry.
Right. I think what I'd really like to see, because I think there's a lot of exciting innovations in crowdsourcing and collecting information, using that for accountability and monitoring purposes. I think actually a little bit of slowing down and stopping to take the time. One, I already talked about this, whether data quality is good and whether the information you're using to monitor or try to keep people accountable is actually representative or the type of information you want to be collecting. And I think even a broader point about that is, as all these people are collecting tons of information and transmitting it in many different ways to the same people or the same populations, to actually try to get some of these folks together to collaborate and think about sort of more systematically platforms or sort of ways to collect information and decide what's important, or allow people to decide what's important and to get that information out there so that it's not just overwhelming. Great.
Great. Thank you all. Those great ideas, and I hope some of us in this room can follow up on some of those. And so we're going to wrap up there. I know one of the issues was clearly technology can be used for good and evil, as came through in that, and there's going to be more on machine learning later, and I wanted to just thank Arman for reminding me I need to be careful in how I use the term AI, because it does have different contextual meanings. And I'll bear that in mind next time out. But again, huge thanks to the panel. Please try and keep a brief 10-minute coffee break so that we can come back for the keynote speaker, and look forward to talking to everybody. Thank you.